from the land of the midnight. It's the philosophy jerks.
Hello and welcome, everyone. We are recording in Think and Drink Studios here in Ann Arbor, Michigan, Josh.
Oh, yes. I know it's not Flint, but hey, we're here.
Yeah, it's not Flint, thankfully. And I already screwed the order here. I'm Brian, joined as always by...
Am I Josh?
Yes, you're Josh.
Okay, I'm Josh.
And this is episode 33 of the Philosophy Jerks. And before I forget it all, Josh, we are the cure for the common conversation.
See, Brian, I know you were really excited because you're back in the Think and Drink studio, like you had mentioned. However, we have a unique setup this time. We, for the first time, are looking directly at each other.
Yes, it's kind of weird. I almost feel like I'm speed dating because I'm looking directly in the eye.
You have 5 minutes to impress me or I'm not sucking your dick.
Yes. This could get contentious looking at each other.
I think
like this.
So.
If there's a point we're disagreeing on, we're staring each other right in the eye.
I know. And if you say something dumb and I roll my eyes, you're going to see it now. It's going to be weird.
Yeah. You're going to see me looking away. You're not truthful in what you're saying, Brian. I see you looking away right now.
Yeah, you're lying. You're just trying to get votes, up votes.
Well, speaking of lying, Josh, there's a town you're from here in the state of Michigan. It seems to be in the news a lot lately.
A lot lately. Of course, I'm from the city of Flint. As I'm sure the entire world by now knows, our government has failed that poor city in their water.
Yeah, to say they failed it. I mean, they failed the most basic... what they provide, protection, what they provide, water, clean
exactly.
Drinking water.
The reason we pay our taxes failed us.
Right. And, living in the empire, so to speak, the United States, we do take water for granted.
Oh, absolutely.
But that's a good thing. We should take water for granted.
Yeah.
Clean drinking water should be easily accessible to everyone.
And coming from, living in Ann Arbor this last year, I have to say it's very weird to be in a city where the tap water looks and feels and tastes like bottled water.
Right. So do you want to get into a little bit? I mean, this whole episode's not going to be about the Flint water crisis, but maybe just a brief synopsis for those who... Is there anyone that doesn't know what's going on?
Anyone that doesn't know what's going on is just not tuned into the news.
Okay.
But essentially, over the last couple of years, the city of Flint had traditionally gotten their water from Detroit, and about 2 years ago, a year and a half ago, they decided to... grab it from the Flint River and disconnect from Detroit.
To cut costs.
To cut costs, of course.
Which is a key part in this whole story.
Yeah, it's the reason this story is so sad.
Right.
But so in doing that, they of course, the water in the Flint River, if anyone who's ever been to Flint knows, is not suitable for human beings. It was very corrosive, and because of the pipes are so old and they're made of lead, the corrosion in the water broke down the leg and the pipes, and the rest is, history.
Right. So, I mean, the basic story of all this is the suffering of people in Flint continues, yes, and gets worse.
I mean, this is a city that's seen horrible, horrible shit in the last 40 years. But this particular problem is especially heinous. Yeah. Because of the long-term effects it's going to have on the children and the brain damage and all that.
And there's... in a situation like this, there's always lots of blame to go around.
Oh, totally.
But in this case, it's starting to be kind of more focused as more information comes to light on how this all happened.
Yeah, definitely. Governor, there is a lot of blame to go around, you're right. But it definitely seems like Snyder, our governor, is going to be the head on the platter for this one.
Yeah, he's going to testify to the federal government here soon. I don't remember the date. It's coming up. They've called him to testify before a committee.
It's like, all right, you called it a national disaster. Let's review why this happened.
So I guess essentially here, just in this intro talking about it, Josh, just since you're from there, you don't live there anymore. We should point out.
I haven't lived there in about 2.5 years.
Pretty much all your formative years.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I was a child there. The only time I've ever been away from Flint is this last 2 years and then the 3 years I was at Central.
So how is it? I guess, how mentally is it affecting you? Because it's not just, it's national news now. It's in the New York Post. It's CNN.
It's worldwide.
Worldwide, yeah.
Al Jazeera reporting on it. Yeah. So does RT. I've seen an article on the RT website. How is it affecting me? One of the main things that's kind of caught me off guard with all of this is the almost upsetness I have that for 40 years, my hometown has just been drugged through the mud and one tragedy after another. And all of a sudden, this water thing is bringing out people like Pearl Jam is getting money for Flint, Michigan.
Yeah.
I'm slightly angered that no one's cared enough to do anything up until this point. And part of me, from the Flint part of me is going, well, you're using this because water is something easily that you can jump on and latch on and get some recognition from. But on the other hand, the more compassionate non-Flint person of me says, well, at least this is something tangible. Like, the problems with Flint have been so ether. Like, they just haven't been, you haven't been able to nail them down. So no one that isn't from there doesn't really know how to help or
pay
do anything.
Attention enough right. to care.
We just at Flint's bag.
Right.
Like Gary, Indiana. Could you tell me what to do in Gary, Indiana to make it better?
Exactly.
Yeah,
I
no
just
one
tell
can.
You it smells and it's dangerous there.
Exactly. Yeah. But if there was a water problem, then you can go, well, fire these people, fix the water, and everything will be fine.
Yeah.
And I'm here to say, even if this water thing ever happened, Flint was in a bad place. Sadly, the real fucked up thing about this whole thing is that the businesses in downtown Flint for the last few years have been on the upswing. And this water crisis is going to do nothing for them.
Nothing, but it's going to kill it. I mean,
I don't think it'll kill it, but within the city. But you're not going to get people coming up from
right. That's where I was going. You're not going to get people outside of Flint coming to go. Oh, let's go to the new fancy restaurant in downtown Flint. I bet you that'll be good.
Right. Even though it's probably perfectly fine. I mean, the water in Flint is coming from Port Huron via Detroit again. The pipe damage is done. But a lot of the pipes in the businesses downtown are not the old leg ones, or rather new.
Yeah.
Because they have to be in order to come up to code and all that. So, there's going to be a lot of misinformation around that.
I guess another thing, too, is we should hold off on this a little bit. Because since you're there, I wanted to get your initial feelings. Because really what this is leading up to is not this episode. We'll get into what this episode's going to be about here in a second. But future episode, probably next episode. You're going to get some little inside info on a trip back up to your hometown.
Definitely. I make no promises, but we have a couple of breweries in town. They all want to go get a growler of beer for our beer review and maybe interview a few people that I know there. And make no promises because I haven't even reached out to people yet.
But either way, we'll get more in depth on the topic as well.
Yeah, I'm going back to Flint next weekend to at least take a look at what's going on here.
So we have that to look forward to.
Yes.
But now let's swing it back around, Josh. This episode is about something a little different. We tried to maybe tie it in, but we just can't quite.
Yeah, we were sitting over our breakfast this morning trying to figure out how to meld Flint and our topic today, which is David Bowie and the Bomb.
Yes, Bowie and the Bomb. Do you want to give a quick synopsis what that's going to entail?
I think I can. David Bowie died. He was a huge influence.
If you haven't noticed.
If you haven't noticed. And he was a huge influence on me. And during my grieving mourning thing, I found a YouTube clip of David Bowie talking a little bit of philosophy with an interviewer. And he said something really interesting. He divided the world before and after, like the Enlightenment period.
Right.
And he said that after God was removed from our consciousness.
After Nietzsche said God is dead.
Right. After Nietzsche said God is dead, we had to replace that big gap in our spirituality. And Bowie claims that the best thing we've done without God is build the bomb.
Yes.
Interesting topic.
It's an interesting topic, something to really bite into, so get excited for that. But before we do any of that, Josh, you know what we always have to do before we undertake a big discussion like that.
Is it the bottle water review?
Maybe if we were in Flint right now. But no, it's the beer review.
Oh, boy.
Beer, beer, beer. I'm going for a beer. Beer, beer, beer. I'm gonna drink some beer. I like drinking beer. Lovely, lovely beer. Beer, beer, beer. I'm going for a beer.
Okay, now, Josh, this is the fifth time we have gotten a beer from this company.
I know, Brian, and I know we swore we would chill out, but the name of the beer was too good not to use. It fits our topic perfectly.
Shorts Brew always pulls us in with the beer names because it usually goes with the show, and their awesome photos on the bottles.
Yeah, their logos and everything are just perfect.
We've said it before. If nothing else, Shorts has the best logos of any craft brew, any beer in the world. I'm going to go in the world, Josh.
In the world?
Yes.
Mm.
The labels.
I don't know if I can disagree with you easily on that. Off the top of my head. But what are we drinking, Brian, by Shorts?
We are drinking Space Rock from Shorts Brewing. It is an American Pale Ale. And it says, it's hopped with tasty little nuggets of alien technology.
Ooh.
So before I read the description, the picture here, we always talk up these pictures.
Yes, of course.
It looks like a guy from Northern Michigan on a snowmobile.
Well, to me, it looked like one of the guys from Life Aquatic.
Oh, it does kind of look
which like. Ties into the David Bowie theme, because the entire soundtrack is covers of David Bowie songs.
Look at these. Look at all these tie-ins.
I'm like a layered. I have layers.
Well, you spent the whole week home sick, too, so yeah, I'm sure that helped to think about
There's nothing that inspires me more than a DayQuil week-long haze.
So, yes, kind of Life Aquatic on a snowmobile cruising through space in an asteroid field.
David Bowie would be proud.
Yes. He's a glass superstar. Okay, so the description from Shorts Brew for Space Rock is, it's a flagship beer, Josh.
Ooh.
Space Rock, now crafted to remove gluten. Oh boy, here we go again.
So wait, did we ever find out if it meant there was no gluten or there was gluten and you just weren't sure?
We never found out. And on the bottle before the description, it says, crafted to remove gluten. The product was fermented from grains containing gluten. The gluten content of this product cannot be verified, and the product may contain gluten.
Again. I'm baffled by the stupidity of it.
So let's see if they say any more in the actual description here. Okay. It is a light-bodied America Pale Ale with prominent floral and orange peel-like hop aromas. Only the slightest grainy malt qualities are detectable as assertive bitter flavors of citrus, rind, and dandelion leaf.
Fucking dandelions.
The finish lingers with a waning bitterness that's not overly dry. Okay, and then there's a little footnote here. All Space Rock packaged after August 1st, 2015, is proven to be gluten removed. Space Rock sold on tap may contain trace amounts of gluten from beer poured previously.
You've done nothing but complicate it. You might as well just not even bother trying to take the gluten out to begin with.
So is there gluten or not? I still...
Well, apparently if this was bottled after August of 2015, it's gluten-free.
I don't really give a shit if there's gluten in this or not.
Well, we don't have an allergy.
Yeah, okay, that's true.
I'm
so insensitive. Yes, I know. The allergy.
Okay. You're such a jerk.
Josh, this is only 5%.
Oh, well, already we're down a star.
Yeah, it's working for the bottom. It's going to have to build up to that thumbs up if it wants it. Okay, so I'm looking at it here in the glass. Not really much of a head. It's just foamy.
Yeah, again, it's got that, like, first piss in the morning look.
Yeah,
and feel to it.
Kind of brownish yellow. Yeah. But it's really see-through, though. You can see it through the glass. That's another
working from the bottom up. If I can see through my beer, I already know I'm going to have to really be impressed to like it.
Yeah, this is maybe before drinking it, this might be more of a summertime beer, but...
Yeah, I could see that, and quite frankly, I don't think I would have bought it in the middle of the winter had it been called anything else.
Yeah.
But all the layers of David Bowie, I had no choice.
And I'm starting to get suspicious that all Shorts does is just make about, like you said earlier, 10 different IPAs, and they just swap out the labels.
Yeah. Maybe put an eyedropper full of flavoring in the new ones or something.
Okay.
Well, let's quit stalling. Let's get through this Shorts beer.
Same studio. Cheers.
Cheers. That does have a waning bitterness.
Yeah.
That kind of hits me, and then the bitterness goes away immediately.
Yeah. It doesn't have a big bitter taste, though.
That's right.
Yeah,
it hits you slightly in the beginning.
Yeah.
How many of these have you had?
Not enough to make a mistake like that.
Come on, get with it.
Get with it. I don't know. It's just a standard IPA. I don't.
Yeah, there's nothing special about this, is there?
No, it's really not. It's just a waning bitterness of an IPA.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, there's no flavor here once the bitterness is gone.
Yeah.
I can taste the grass.
You know, I don't like that grass.
Yeah, the grass is... I don't mind it, but it usually throws me off.
Well, I mean, I guess that's something to be said for Shorts. The ones we don't like, we don't completely rip them apart other than prolonged enjoyment.
Yeah, prolonged. 2.9?
Yeah, whatever that weak alcohol content was. But this, I don't know. I mean, it's not bad. It's just, I can't...
I wouldn't go out of my way to get this.
No, and I can't give it a thumbs up.
I can't either. Again, though, you're right. There's not a lot to tear this beer apart with. It's just that Shorts is so prolific, and I've had so much by them that this isn't good enough to stand out among their other beers.
Which is surprising because it's one of their flagship beers, but...
Yeah. I think it's the gluten removal process.
Well, when you've reviewed 33 beers now, you kind of have to impress, and this hasn't impressed at all.
Yeah, I'm really sad we didn't capitalize on the Dirty 30.
I know, for our 30.
We fucked that up, didn't we?
All right, we'll have to do it when we get to the 40.
The 40 ounces to freedom episode.
Yes.
Nice.
So, all right, so no surprise. Thumbs down for Space Rock.
Two thumbs down, definitely. I'm right there with you on that one. I feel cheated to have bought this beer. I'll put it that way.
Yeah, well, there's always more in the fridge.
I guess. You know, there's some of that root beer left in there.
Oh, all right. We can hit that up later.
Yeah, well, James, quickly.
Yeah.
James, I'll tell a little story about James. Our super fan, James M. Powers, went out directly and bought a six-pack of the Not Your Father's root beer that we reviewed. It was officially the first root beer that he was, or the first beer he was able to find out there that we reviewed. And I think it was a fang thing more than a taste thing, because yes. I know those aren't good.
Well, I mean, we both gave it a thumbs up.
I gave it a thumbs up for one at a time, maybe two.
Yeah.
Well, he's suckling on them day in, day out for 3 days straight.
Hey, well, if he, if our review got him to try it and now he really likes it, hey.
Hey, I'll get
you're
fair
welcome,
enough.
James.
Taste is subjective.
All right. So, two thumbs down, like we said, for Space Rock.
Shorts Brewing.
Shorts Brewing, yes. Two out of three shorts.
Get with it.
Stick with us. We're going to be covering Bowie and the Bomb.
Cub Louie.
Beer, beer, beer. I'm going for a beer. Beer, beer, beer. I'm going to drink some beer. I like drinking beer. Lovely, lovely beer. Beer, beer, beer. I'm going for a beer.
All right, guys, on the count of three, do your best gun sounds at philosophyjerks.com.
One, two, three.
I'm afraid of Americans. I'm afraid of the world. I'm afraid I can't help it. I'm afraid I can't. I'm afraid of Americans. I'm afraid of the world. I'm afraid I can't help it. I'm afraid I can't. Yeah, I'm afraid of Americans. I'm afraid of the words. I'm afraid I can't help it. I'm afraid I can't. I'm afraid of Americans.
Okay, so if you haven't heard, David Bowie passed away.
Did he?
Yeah, he did.
Weird. Hey, you know the most weird thing about David Bowie passing? Is like a week later they found the ninth planet.
Oh, yes.
That's the David Bowie planet.
Planet 9 is all they're calling it, right?
Planet 9. It should be Planet 10, but, Pluto.
Yeah, well.
Fuck you, Neil deGrasse Tyson.
That's a discussion for another day. But with David Bowie passing, Josh, I know it kind of hit you personally hard.
Oh, definitely. He was one of the quintessential rockers in my youth that kind of pioneered my love for, like, all the various kinds of music that I listened to, right? Like, he's the one that said there's more to music than just hard rock and roll.
Right.
And I just, a true legend has passed in my life. And a lot of it was, I think a lot of it that bothered me the most was realizing that, holy shit, all this is going to start to happen more and more and more. And these huge icons that have always been in the consciousness of me are going to be gone now. And
right.
It's like losing a parent in a way.
Right. And somehow Steven Tyler and Keith Richards are still among us.
But their time's coming. I'm predicting Keith Richards will be dead in less than 5 years.
It's a bold prediction.
I think I'm right.
All right. So anyways, after David Bowie passed and you had these thoughts about this kind of age and generation passing, it led you to go over some stuff from David Bowie, not just songs, but interviews.
Oh, definitely. I mean, he had a profound effect on things like the stock market and the internet and all that. And it kind of led me down a rabbit hole of, what other than movies and music was David Bowie into?
Come to find out, there was philosophy to David
Bowie. A lot to philosophy to David Bowie. But one particular interview was the one I shared with you in preparation for the show. And that was David Bowie basically talking about life before and after the Enlightenment and the spiritual death in the West.
So, like we always do, this is going to be a little bit of an audio special of defining our terms. So, David Bowie, take it away and
define the term.
People were so aggrandized with their own sense of science and the aftermath of the Enlightenment and how man himself could improve the world. Then, of course, it led to things like Nietzsche saying God is dead, and it led to Einstein's discovery that time and space aren't what we thought they were, and Freud an understanding of another kind of human inside the human. All these things culminated in the idea that everything we'd known before was wrong. Everything. So we start out the 20th century with this clean slate. We are now the gods. And the greatest thing that we could do as God during that century was create the bomb.
It's so funny to listen to him talk, isn't it?
It is. He's kind of, well, you know, that British accent to an American always catches your ear.
Well, true, but, well, for one, there's no such thing as a British accent. There's like 40 different dialects there. But I get what you mean. But the funny thing about David Bowie was when he would go into like recording studios, like lower, lesser known ones, after he got well established in Britain, he would go in and talk with a Cockney accent, which is essentially going in and talking with a Southern drawl,
right,
in American. And he would always do that to make people comfortable, because after a day or two of recording, he would slowly come out of that and back into his normal.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Another, just to make people feel comfortable.
Yeah, he was just like the definition of a gentleman and a scholar.
So, well, let's focus in a little bit what he was talking about there. The big part of that is what? The end of the Enlightenment in the course of human history, more so European history, but it affected people globally.
Yeah, I think so, eventually especially. But yeah, life before the Enlightenment and after the Enlightenment. And in true fashion, in order to talk about it, he reduces a lot of things down into like a key event, and that's Nietzsche saying God is dead.
Right. Which eventually, well, he points it out too, where it's we replace everything that we learned about spirituality, about our belief in God or gods, was wrong. You know, I mean, we have contrary evidence to the point. So, in his point, we're switching from our purpose is just to praise the gods to, oh, maybe now
we're the gods.
We're the gods.
You know, and what can we do with our powers?
And what can we achieve?
And I think I feel safe in assuming that he was saying that the end result, the highest thing that we've done in a life without the spirituality leading us, was the bomb, the H-bomb, the atomic weapon.
That's what he puts forth, right?
Right,
All our marvels of science just led to the most effective and devastating way to kill each other.
Absolutely. And he said that's like the best thing that we're capable of.
So I guess that leads to the question, Josh. There's evidence to point that he's right, in a sense, right?
Absolutely. I mean, they call it the atomic age.
Yeah. I mean, Europeans and Americans, too, when you count the world wars, we took our advancements in technology and science and we turned them on each other.
Absolutely. When we dropped the bombs on Japan at the end of World War II, it wasn't a spiritual thing. It wasn't a, you know, I mean, people were saying, may God help us, I think, more out of obligation. And like tradition, more than they actually fear what God would think about that.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I think it kind of harkens back to what he said, like the time before technology was at the forefront of everything we did, everything was in praise of the God and fear of gods.
Well, that's the curious thing, right? I was going to touch on the fear of God here. Before the Enlightenment, especially in like the Baptist sect of Christianity, the fear of God was instrumental.
Right.
And
a spider in the hands of an angry God. Have you read that one before?
I have, yes. Yeah. The sermon where you're held over the gates of hell or the pit of hell or whatever.
God's just waiting to drop you.
Exactly. Waiting for you to fuck up so he can drop you. Well, it's really curious, right? Because that fear never really went away. It kind of like went underground until the bomb came about. Mm-hmm. And with the bomb, it's turned into, instead of pissing off God, don't piss off the United States.
Right.
Or they'll drop the bomb.
Well, and it's the culmination of our fear of, look at all the power that we've now had and look what we did with it.
Right.
We just found a highly effective way to wipe each other out.
And
so there's all sorts of questions, though, too. I mean, is that, you're left to ask yourself, is that what humans are, is that essential to our nature, killing each other?
for me, philosophically, I don't think we have a nature. I think we have a story that we tell each other generation after generation that we adhere to. But that's really a lot different than you were born to do this. But that being said, I think the story we tell ourselves is something along those lines where it's, you know, be good, fall in line, be a good team player, or we're going to bomb you.
Right.
And I think that in the 50s and 60s where, you know, Bowie came to age with that kind of thinking, that was a very real threat. I mean, we were teaching our kids to hide from atomic fallout and blasting.
Well,
all
people
that.
Were building shelters to hide out from the
nuclear Mickey
fallout.
Mouse gas masks.
Right.
Right. In World War One too. But so that mentality, yeah, was there all along. But I do think we're moving away from it quite a bit. Right now, we're not so much. I mean, the fear of a major world power dropping a bomb on you is there. But I think the more vivid threat is sanctions and having the UN pissed off at you and no one, you know, helping you out.
Right.
I think that's a bigger threat, which I think is a testament to the little bit of maturity we've made as a species.
Well, yes, even right after right after dropping the bomb, the Soviets famously developed the bomb as well.
And oh, yeah.
There was the doctrine of mutually assured destruction, which is what probably kept us from a full-out nuclear war, was knowing that if you dropped a nuclear bomb, well, your enemy has the same capability, and all you're going to do is wipe each other out.
So. Right, and probably most of the world.
Right, and probably the world with it. So that's not an effective strategy. How do we mature past that point? And I think what we're getting to with this is, while we don't fully disagree with Bowie, there is an aspect that we do disagree, because from that time period, in that era, and we full-on live in the technology and information era now, because something else was developed alongside the bomb.
Absolutely. And in a lot of ways, because of the bomb.
Yeah.
And that's the internet. And I personally think that the internet has played a more pivotal role in the shaping of our consciousness than the bomb. The bomb really shaped one aspect of our consciousness, and that was to fear each other. The internet has that there with it, you know, cyberbullying and anonymous and all of that. But there's also GoFundMe and helping each other out. There's all this information that's out there that you can better yourself on the internet.
There's the ability to talk to anyone from around the world.
Exactly. Get to know your enemy, right?
Exactly. And, you know, when you get to know anyone, even someone you don't like, even, let's say, in your own town, when you get to know someone and their life story and what they do on a daily basis, you realize there's a lot of things that aren't that different. It's
right.
It's harder to dehumanize someone when you get to know
exactly.
them.
Exactly. And while you can convince people to hate each other, even after they get to know each other, it's going to be really hard to get them to want to, you know, shoot them when you haven't done the work to dehumanize them. Mm-hmm. But on the flip side, because of the internet and the connectivity it brings, rather than dehumanize the human or the enemy, we've dehumanized the act of killing via, like, remote drones.
Yeah.
So, like, the people that do the act, it's just like playing a video game to them.
Well, that's always... That is something that I don't think we have gotten over yet, because with the advance of technology, I mean, World War II still holds such a place in our consciousness, because that's really the first war where on a large scale you could kill people from a distance. You don't have to look them face to face when you're killing them.
Right.
You drop the bomb from 20,000 feet above and you see the explosion, but you don't see the devastation up close that it causes.
Right.
And now that's accelerated to the point where you're right. You're not even in the plane anymore. You're sitting in a video game room and... you know, in the desert in Nevada, dropping bombs on someone halfway across the world.
Well, I mean, is it really? I don't even think it's a desert in Nevada. I think it's like an office building in Langley.
Yeah.
You know, it's just a matter of fact.
Mm-hmm. Which is interesting, because that's opening. I don't want to divulge into this too much, but that's opening a whole new area in psychology of a different kind of post-traumatic stress disorder, having such a dehumanized disconnection from killing someone from such a distance that
right.
it doesn't seem real. A lot of the guys that have been doing that job are struggling with so many questions about it, moral, conscientious,
sure.
you know, psychological. So,
and a lot of those are just like version 2.0 of the same struggles that have been there since war has been a thing.
And to get away from that, I only see one conclusion, is to just take the human out of it, let the program it and let the robot take care
right.
of it.
Right. But now we're back at the famous question of instead of going to war, why not have kings play chess?
Yeah.
And we know why that doesn't work. It's because, well, if I lose at chess, I can put a bullet in your brain and, right. and take your land.
Right.
You know, I don't have to be good at chess to do that. And But to kind of like bring it into like a nice neat package here in this first half, to wrap it up a little bit. I think that we both agree that David Bowie was on to something about the bomb, but I think we both agree that it's more than that. But one thing I want to point out is that aspects of God and spirituality have survived into this. With the internet, we have an all-seeing, all-knowing eyeball in the sky that's no longer God watching you masturbate. It's the NSA watching you masturbate.
Right, yeah.
So, that same anxiety and that same worry and effect on the consciousness is still there. It's just now we can say, well, we're doing that to each other. And there's a little bit of hope there, because with God, it was something that you'd never be able to touch, see, or get involved with. With the, like I say, we can have a Snowden, turn rogue, or we could all rush Virginia and take over all that.
Mm-hmm.
So there's something lucid there. And I think that
tangible.
It's tangible, yeah.
You see it, you know what's there. It's not up to an interpretation of someone else.
Totally. But, that leads us into something I want to dissect in the second half. But before we do that, we can go and get a break. And that's simply, in a world without God, is there any meaning? And if there's no meaning, what does that mean for us people? So I think we should take a quick break, listen to some David Bowie-related music, and come back and talk about existentialism, David Bowie style.
Ooh, get ready.
There we go. Ashes to ashes. Funk to funky.
Stick with us. It's the Philosophy Jerk.
All right, I'm recording. Say what you want from this point forward, and it's recording.
Okay. Yeah, I need to meditate on it for a second. Hello, you're listening to the Philosophy Jerks, the finest podcast available.
For strategic thought.
I thought I was able to handle the power. I've always been a kind and gentle person. But when I was finally able to split the atom, I built me a bomb and I dropped it on every who got in my way.
evidence of what we had done by standing in for this idea of morality ourselves, creating it all ourselves, so destroyed our fix on what we should be doing in life that we're still living through that chaos right now. We have no spiritual lives to speak of. There's quasi-new religions, but there is no direct sense of what our purpose is anymore. Now, that may be a good thing, because it may show itself to be that we, in fact, don't have a purpose. Are we big enough or mature enough to exist like that? Are we mature enough to accept that there's no plan, there's no going somewhere?
All right, welcome back. Josh, as I age a little bit, I feel more mature on things. The problem I have is I never know if that's a positive or a negative, but experience can't help but breed maturity.
Sure, but experience and maturity can also breed conformity and traditionalism.
Yes, it can.
And stagnant water, if you will.
Dirty water.
Ugh, Flint water.
Okay, so we played a little bit more Bowie from that interview that has struck us.
And it moved me.
Yes, intellectually so.
Ooh.
He brings up the point, but maybe it's not so much a bad thing that we turned away from a old-style spiritual life. This is the existentialist in him.
Right.
And he asked the question, though, if that's the case, are we mature enough as a species, as a being, to go past that?
Well, not even just go past that, right? It's can we handle without God?
Can we handle that knowledge?
Right.
Yes.
Not life without God, more so, is like you say, a life without meaning, purpose.
Yes. Let's go with that angle.
And let's, think about it here. Would you tell a 4-year-old or an 8-year-old that there's no purpose in life and you have to do the work to create it, and when you die, you're dead forever?
Yeah, you know, I don't have kids, so I can't say, 100% sure, but I've thought about that before. I don't want to raise, if I had kids, I wouldn't want to raise them to have hopelessness.
No, but there is a point where you don't give them the whole story until their brain or their consciousness has developed to a point where they can understand it in a meaningful way.
Yeah. That's almost why I want to keep Santa Claus, because I want them to figure out on their own that Santa Claus doesn't exist. And when that happens, I feel like that's when I can slowly start the process
I guess
that's
an easy
the idealized
thing.
Non-parent thinking.
I'd rather do the same thing, but instead of Santa Claus, we replace it with like a helpful and meaningful government.
Okay.
You know,
ooh, it's game night at the Trimble House.
I'm pissed at the government, especially local Michigan government. You failed us, Snyder.
Oh man, your kids are going to be annoying in school, Josh.
I won't have kids.
Okay. Well, good for all of us.
Yeah. This bloodline stops here. I've neutered my brother in his sleep, and I'm about to take the plunge myself.
Well, you know, we bring up this point of how do you maturely raise children, right? And I think this kind of parallels, or I'm going to make the parallel if it doesn't. It parallels, let's say, the maturity of humanity.
Definitely the course of time, parallels. Right?
And so we're kind of at the point where maybe humans are starting to realize, oh, Santa Claus doesn't actually exist. I've just been told that. Now, you know, how do I still enjoy Christmas going forward? I mean, that's, you know, such a small example, but I like the analogy. And I think Bowie's right. I think we're at a place in the course of humanity where it's, can we accept that maybe there is no grand meaning to our life? It's only what we make of it.
Right. And I mean, earlier in the interview, he had proposed that spirituality gave it meaning, and that the act of taking it away took away the meaning with it, right? So, in a way, the real question is do we keep telling ourselves that Santa Claus is real, knowing that if it isn't, we're just going to break down? And, you know, it kind of reminds me of the plot point in the Firefly Serenity universe with the Reavers and how they came about. Spoiler alert for Firefly.
Wee-oo.
If you haven't seen Firefly, you're dead to me. Wee-oo. So, spoiler alert, in the movie Serenity, we learn how the Reavers came about. And it was through some, you know, manipulation of the atmosphere that the government was trying to create a passive person, right? Someone that would just kind of accept the government and the role and blah, 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 blah. That's not important. What I think is important is the concept of where the Reavers came from, and that a certain small percentage of the population didn't become complacent, didn't lay down and just do nothing until death. they became violent, horrible versions of humanity that would rape and kill for no reason. Mm-hmm. And they realized there was no meaning to life. And so what they did with that knowledge is just completely destroy everything, supervillain style. But the curious thing is the what everybody else did, and that was the huge bulk of a people, and that was just simply lay down and die, just give up.
Mm-hmm.
And I think when we ask ourselves, like Bowie is asking, are we mature enough? I think the bottom line is are we ready to take on that knowledge that there's nothing out there? Are we ready to have a third option, right? Are we not going to go completely crazy and kill each other with the bomb? Or are we not just going to sit on our couch and watch YouTube until our arteries clog and we keel over and die? Is there a third option? Is there something else out there?
Mm-hmm.
And that's a good question. I don't know. I don't know the answer to that. I think I want to say there are.
Yeah.
The millennial generation is getting me excited for the future. But part of me thinks that it's just extending the Santa Claus myth.
Yeah.
You know, instead of God, we're just going to space.
Yeah, exactly. Thinking that we'll find our forever meaning in space, too.
Right.
You know, you can't say one way or the other. You're right. It's the same way. In a lot of ways, it feels like the extension of the Santa Claus myth.
Totally.
You know, it's interesting. I don't know either. But it worries me when I run into someone that truly believes that without the... how should I put it? The scariness of doing wrong based on spirituality, right?
Right.
Like if you, why would you do wrong? You're going to be punished forever. But my thought is always, if that's your only motivation to do good, what's the point of being good?
If
you're only good because of your fear of what the repercussions could be, then you're not. I feel you're not really good at. You're good anyways. You're just manipulated good.
Okay. Well, let me be devil's advocate here. Couldn't we make the same parallel question or argument about eating healthy? Like, we're only eating healthy because we were told to eat healthy. Mm-hmm. And that's the thing to do. I mean, is there a parallel there at all between that?
No, I think so. And when I think about it, it's funny because, you know, I try to not eat terrible, but I don't stick to a regimen. And I think my...
spirituality reflects that as well with God.
It does. Yeah. It does.
Yeah, that's...
You know, it's like, yeah, you're right. I bet McDonald's is a bad idea, but sometimes I'll eat the McDonald's and I'm perfectly fine with it because...
life goes on.
Yeah, life goes on. It's what I wanted to do. It didn't make me drop dead right then and there.
Right. Well, but that comes up to another interesting aspect of all of this. And that aspect is simply, are we able to make decisions that will affect us in the future but not... directly in the present,
yeah.
Like smoking and eating horribly.
I think that's where the maturity in it comes,
right?
As a species,
I don't know. I don't. I mean, we are as a species, and David Bowie hints at that in his interview. We have a hard time living in the present day,
yeah.
Let alone trying to do present day after present day after present day into the future and plan that way. I mean, it's just the future is this weird, cloudy abstract that we try to make concrete.
Mm-hmm.
And it usually never comes out that way. So, I mean, if we're unable to predict what the weather's going to be like tomorrow, I mean, are we really ready to say what this pack of cigarettes or this McDonald's is going to do to us in the future? Not on a science level, but on a health and like personal spiritual mm-hmm. level. You know, maybe you develop Alzheimer's and you completely corrupt all of your hard work intellectually because you kept eating Big Macs.
Right. Right.
You know, I mean,
that's part of the, you know, that's part of the unknown. That's the problem, because even if, let's say we do get mature enough, right? Let's take this out of it. We're mature enough. We're developing our own future and we're unafraid of it. And then boom, a meteor hits Earth and it's all over with. And it was all for naught anyways. I think that knowledge is kind of what scares the maturity into the future, right? It's right back to it could just all be meaningless.
Well, I mean, it ultimately will be meaningless, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, our solar system is going to die. The sun is going to expand before it collapses in on itself. The universe is probably going to cool and expand to a point where life isn't nothing. Light won't be possible, let alone life.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and intellectually, anyone that reads and gives a damn about being aware and intellect knows that there is an ultimate end to this entire universe.
Right.
And so somewhere deep in our mind, we know that there's a high probability that none of this will matter ever. I mean, the Native Americans have a saying of the Native Americans, like they're all one fucking tribe. There is a
the
belief,
noble savage.
Yeah, there is a belief that came from North America. I forget what tribe it came from. And it might even be true. It might be something I heard when I was a kid. But they say you die three deaths, right? You die the death of when you die normally. You die the death of when your bones and your body completely disintegrate. And then finally, you die the death of when the last person alive remembers you dies.
Yeah.
And so that kind of thing, the parallel there is that the universe kind of does the same thing with us. You know, eventually there's going to be a point in time where the universe has no more evidence that we were ever here. You know, the sun might completely destroy the planets that we lived on in the solar system.
Yeah.
Or a black hole gobbles up the entire Milky Way and we never make it out of the Milky Way. You know, who's there to know we were ever here?
Right.
You know, all that. And look at that Carl Sagan with his pale blue dot comparison. You know, all the wars, all the blood, yada, 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 spilled on this pale blue dot. Yeah. Everyone that's ever lived has been on this pale blue dot.
Yeah.
You know, we don't even have to leave the solar system to see that we're insignificant.
And yeah. Yeah, I know. Just look at the picture of the Earth from the moon. And
yeah, right.
Just that. How small do you feel?
So, and I think, honestly, people like you and me, we handle that knowledge by suppressing what it ultimately means and just kind of going about forward and ignoring that aspect.
It's the same way with just your own death, I think, right? I mean, we're talking the grand death. It's the same thing. You can be aware of it all you want, but if you sit and focus on it all day.
Well, and that begs a question. I want to ask you a question on that thing. If that's like what you should do in order to not get wrapped up into it, you and I are philosophers. We've been told multiple times we think too hard about it.
Mm-hmm.
Well, is that maturity? Is maturity about this whole thing just ignoring it? Or is maturity looking at it in a real way and going forward after that?
I know. That's
I'm directly asking you that question, Brian. What do you think?
I don't know. I don't care if this comes off as arrogant. I usually try to be humble on this stuff. But I think that there can be no progress forward in any kind of thought without examining it. And even if you're the one that doesn't come up with the new way of thinking of it, I think there's been not just the grand question of death and what does that mean, but I think anything, any mental advancement in the course of humanity, and I say that there have been, you know, there's a reason that we're not just going and raiding the other neighborhood for food.
We've
talked about it and thought why that's not a good idea and how we could do this better. So, yes, I think that the ultimate maturity lies in examining this, and there are people far smarter than me that could probably examine it even better. But I think that needs to be done. I think that's where the maturity comes from. I think that comes through with the ultimate questions, the grand questions of life, to the questions of your own life. I mean, there's stuff you question when you're a child into a teenager that leads you into how you think as an adult.
Well, that's fine and all, but what do you do with the natural conclusion of it's meaningless? The universe is never going to remember we were here. How do you get past the why bother?
That's still the ultimate tough question for me.
Well, I think the mature thing to do is at least a little
to
bit
say,
cut the edge off and go, if that doesn't matter, don't think about
okay.
that.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think you're right. Because, I mean, that's how most of us live day to day.
It's
good to be reminded of it, but I can't get through day to day just constantly thinking about it.
Of course not. If you think about the brooding philosophers that we were in our early 20s,
mm-hmm.
and I don't know about you, but like the concept of it's all meaningless.
Well, you said it the other night, like screw getting old. There's times at 22 years old where I wake up at 2 a.m, scratching my head going, oh my God, it could all mean nothing.
Right, exactly. Yeah. Right. Why do you have to wait till 70 in order to realize that?
Right.
But that's the thing, right? Is when we were younger, socially, scientifically, philosophically, every Lee that we can come up with, all depends on not giving in to complete nihilism and not giving in to, well, there's no point.
Mm-hmm.
Not being Eeyore. Eeyore didn't build anything. Eeyore didn't do anything.
He was just there.
He was just there, hanging out.
Yeah.
You know, and in order to get past that intellectually, I think the only option you have is to lie to yourself a little.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe the act of lying to yourself isn't the mature thing. Maybe being aware and wise enough to know which lie to tell yourself is the mature act. But I don't think we can get past the idea of lying to ourselves.
I don't think so.
Did I just completely convince you oppositely of what you thought earlier?
No, I still think what I did earlier. I still think it is necessary to examine it from time to time and think about what that leads to. But I think practically, I can't live every day in the proverbial ivory tower. Right,
right.
I'm not afforded that. And nor do I think I should necessarily be afforded that either. So you're right. I do have to lie to myself a little bit to keep going every day, day to day. I think a lot of people agree that it's important to try to remind yourself of day to day.
So
enjoy today.
I completely carpe diem, yeah. Carpe diem, as from a Mick Ming call out from exactly. Back in the day. But I think at the end of the day, this is what made David Bowie such a pivotal person, and why I grieve his loss so much. Is because here we are. We're not even talking music. No, David Bowie. We took a couple of ideas that David Bowie probably read in a book somewhere, and we made an hour podcast out of it. And we're energized, and we're talking about these things in a way that we normally wouldn't.
Which is why, and I want to put this out there, which is why his death affected you, I think, so much. It's more than just, oh, I want people to see I really like David Bowie.
Right, exactly.
On my social media. It's like, no, there's stuff that David Bowie said that imprinted on your own life.
Absolutely. It's like when Charles Bukowski died in 94, I wasn't into him at all then, but I got into Charles Bukowski by 99 2000, mm-hmm. And that was only 7 years later, and when I realized who he was and realized that he had died when I was alive, that affected me. Mm-hmm. Kurt Cobain, I know, affected you when he died.
Bill Hicks,
both of us.
Yeah.
And I think the point here is simply that there's a void where a well used to be. You know, think of it like the star going out, right? The sun.
Right.
We directly are affected by that, even though we don't personally go to the sun, hang out with the sun, buy it drinks, and it comes to our house.
Right, yeah.
You know, there's a lack. There's definitely a lack in a world without David Bowie.
You want to be reminded that well or that star was there.
Totally.
Yeah.
And again, David Bowie was such a chameleon, so prolific in everything that he did, that he means something completely different to everybody on the same level of degree of intensity. I know people that are on Wall Street. I got one person on Wall Street that doesn't like David Bowie's music, never really watched any of the movies was in, but because he had these things called Bowie Bonds, where he would sell bonds based on the royalties of his previous work going forward in the future.
Wow.
And he did that to fund BowieNet, which is his ISP. Well, because he did that, because of the Bowie bonds, because that came about, the freedom to invest in weird shit on Wall Street, like Beats headphones and, I don't know,
WWE
ice cream, shit like that. Because of Bowie bonds, things like that became more accepted on Wall Street. And because of those things being more accepted, we have a more liberal, or not liberal, but more
open-minded
representation on Wall Street. That's huge. I never even thought David Bowie in that way. And when he told me that, my friend told me that over the internet, it blew me away. You know, and so, again, to wrap it all up and to kind of do a thank you to David Bowie, I wanted to take some of his philosophical thoughts that he could shit out in an interview one day. And here we are talking about it in a way that I've been thinking about it for weeks. Yeah. I don't know about you.
Yeah.
And it's just incredible. So the world is definitely less without David Bowie in it.
More that he was here.
Absolutely more that it was here. And I'll end on this. Simon Pegg was quoted on this, but it was actually another Twitter user that day. And I'm going to paraphrase it. I'll have it right here in front of me. But if you're sad that David Bowie died, just think that, you know, in a world, in a universe as old as it is, in a world as old as it is, we were lucky enough to be alive while David Bowie was. How cool is that?
Yep, exactly.
Amazing.
It's a great thought. And with that thought, we're going to have to wrap it up. I want you to leave on that. But don't go anywhere, though. There's still Q&A coming, Josh.
Oh, now I have to say, we don't have any James Powers questions this week.
We don't. That's okay. You know, James is always there for us, but we need a little break from James. We got some outside questions. So we're going to tackle those And we'll see what comes of that, if it matters at all.
I don't think it will. I think we're maturing up to know that, but stick with us after the break. More David Bowie-related stuff.
Q&A coming up next on The Philosophy Jerks.
Seu dinheiro é seu. Ei, baby, seu cabelo é legal. Moda na gringa é Feliz Natal. Se equivocou, mas ficou tudo bem. Agora disso está na onda zen. Ei, baby, você venceu. Passe amanhã e pegue o que é seu. A maquiagem vai desmanchar. Faz o seu medo aparecer. 0-0, agora eu vou. Você deu mole, então eu marco o gol. 0-0, você venceu. Passe amanhã e pegue o que é seu.
I'm a computer, and just like you, I am listening to the Philosophy Jerks.
I'm just waiting for the Sunday mail.
When you control the mail, you control information.
Okay, here we go. Still not digging the space rock, Josh. I'm trying to finish it off here. Because you need it for cute. Oh, look at that. I did finish it off.
Oh, look at that. Complete- I switched to scotch.
Scotchy, scotchy.
Scotchy, scotchy.
You know, you need the drinks for the Q&A portion of the show.
Well, that's what makes us, that's what gives us our jerk power.
Yes. Jerk juice.
Jerk juice. Don't, no, I don't want to call it that. That's a little weird.
Jerk juice. All right.
That's like something you find in an old t-shirt in my room.
I know, right? Wasted youth. Okay, Q&A time. Remember, you can always go to philosophyjerks.com/QA to send us the formal Q&A question.
That's right. You can even do it anonymously.
Anonymously, yes. You can do it right on the Facebook group. That's always cool, too.
Twitter,
at The Philosophy Jerks.
No, at Philosophy Jerks.
Oh, you're right.
You always get that messed up, Brian.
At Philosophy Jerks.
Come on.
And I'm the one that does all the time.
I know, you run all that. We're a failure.
All right.
Let's just get the first question.
Imposter syndrome. Anyways, here's the first question that was sent to us. This is from Chris. It says, "Hey, Philosophy Jerks. This is both a question for Josh and Brian. Is there a philosophical question you get hung up on or one that you find keeps coming up?"
That's actually a really appropriate question because the one that keeps coming up for me is the lack of meaning.
Yes.
In the world. Like, because if you think of between free will and
You're stealing my thunder already. That was going to be the question. Let's just tie it in together.
Let's go together.
Because that's the question that always comes up for me, too. And I don't have an answer, but I love questioning and thinking about free will. Does free will exist or does it not? Is it determined or is there free will?
Yeah, that one is a specialty of mine. I've been studying that.
I've been talking about that since we've been friends.
15 years almost now.
Yeah.
But for me recently, the meaning or lack of meaning in the universe, that one keeps coming up. I'm always thought that Camus was edgy with his question, "The only true philosophical problem is should I commit suicide?" I always thought it was edgy, but I didn't really know what that meant other than, "What, are you emo?"
Right.
But the older I get and the more I study the meaning or lack of meaning in the world, the more I can start to understand that philosophical point of his, you know, is it even worth doing anything?
Right.
I think it is, and I think Camus ultimately landed on, yeah, it is.
He's just making you ask the question.
Right, because through asking the question, you look at your life a little bit.
It's something you need as a teenager. I think that's why teenagers love Camus so much. Or I did as a teenager.
I must have been in arrested development because I didn't like Camus until I was like 23.
All right. Like 18, 19. I'm like, yeah, fuck it. It means nothing.
Start smoking.
But and along with that, the free will question too. And I mean, my God, you and me have talked about, you know, is there free will, is there not? And ultimately we say, well, who cares really, because you won't be able to find out one way or another.
That's what you say. I say that the question of free will isn't even a real philosophical question or problem.
Okay. Yes. Conclusion-wise, though, I think we usually get to the same place.
Sure, but...
we both just stopped talking about it at that point.
I mean, we were both coming from where we live to meet in Kalamazoo. We're going to the same place, but our experiences getting there are very different.
Right, right. What always strikes up the free will question for me, though, is something that drives me nuts, is when people will say, everything happens for a reason. But then they'll say, well, I have free will. No.
Those are not mutually exclusive.
It's one or the other.
Absolutely.
And it's fine. If you want to say everything happens for a reason, I can't really fully prove you wrong. But you can't then go say, well, then I have free choice of everything that I do.
Well, and that
then nothing happens for a reason.
Well, that falls back to a problem in philosophy across the board, and that's people's inability to take a logical conclusion off of one philosophical thought and apply it accurately across the board.
Yeah.
God exists, but there's I have free will.
Yeah, right. Yeah, this is the problem with taking logic class at some point in your life, too. It could really make you an asshole because you got to, like, people will say this stuff and it drives you nuts.
Well, I think the thing that brings the asshole out in me is it's so simple to see.
Yeah.
And people blatantly don't. And it just drives me nuts.
So don't do that when talking to us.
Yeah, don't be dumb. Get your shit together, internet.
That's right. All right, let's go to the next question. This comes from Derek DS, which I'm guessing is
80shorror.net.
Yeah. Derek, yes.
I'm thinking it is.
Big supporter and fan of the show. He's been on a few times. Go back and listen to those. But here's what he sends us as a question. He says, hey, guys. All excited. Exclamation. All excited.
I'm on the show now.
Hey, remember me.
Don't be pedantic.
You want to see my master's degree? All right. He says, hey, guys. What were a few of your favorite films of 2015? That's the first part of his question.
2015.
Pretty easy for me. I can think of a few right off the bat. Mad Max Fury Road.
Yeah, that was definitely one of my favorites.
Movie melted my face off, and I loved it.
The D-Box, where I get to let my muscles go.
Yeah, that's going to be a memory for me for a while. It probably won't be as good, you know, watching it home even on a good television. But, man, going to the theater to see that was great.
I'm surprised you didn't lead the gate with Star Wars.
Well, that's number two. That's the next one.
That's number two?
Well, I don't know. Just right here on the spot, I'm trying to make a top list. But, yeah, that's one that sticks out in my head.
Man, see, when we talked about it, like right after you watched Star Wars, I could have swore you had a little piece of Abrams cum on your lip there.
No, it didn't go that far. I was fair. When we first talked about it, I said, 7.5, 8 out of 10. No need to retread this too much, but love Star Wars. Prequels really killed a lot of the love for me. And so this one, I was excited, no doubt. I was super excited, but it still needed to deliver. I'm older now. I wasn't going to go through the Phantom Menace effect of going, yeah, it's pretty good.
I guess.
No, I left going, man, that was fun. I want to see it again, and I'm excited for the next movie. And that's exactly everything I wanted from a new Star Wars movie.
Well, I will agree with you on that. And I will say that Star Wars was one of my favorite experiences of 2015 in terms of movies. But as far as actual movie goes, I'm going to have to say Turbo Kid.
I didn't like that.
You didn't like Turbo Kid?
I didn't like it. No.
Oh, man.
I know that puts me in a...
No, I mean, it's so bizarre and weird enough that it makes sense that people that like good movies wouldn't necessarily like it.
Right. I'm not going to go film snob with it. I just didn't have fun with it.
Yeah, I had a blast with that movie. Definitely one of my favorites this year. My other one, if I had to like...
Pull them out on the spot.
Yeah, pull them on the spot. I'm not looking at a list. I'm recalling from memory off the top of my head, and I have a little bit of scotch in me right now. I will have to say, I think it was called Sicario. I think that was the name of it.
Yeah, okay.
The drug movie that came out this year. I really liked that movie, not because it was a well-acted, and it was a well-acted drug cop movie. But I liked it because it was a movie about being raped, but there was never real rape talked about directly. Like, one scene it was alluded to, man on man, but, like, the dialogue, the way everything was shot... how like the U.S. government was going after the Mexican drug lords, and like, I mean, just some of the verbiage, even, like for instance, when Benicio Volturo.
Del Toro.
Del Toro. Went and got one of the main drug pings in there. He kept saying, just relax, sit back, and let it happen over and over in a very aggressive way. And his legs were, like, it was weird.
Yeah.
But it was... I'm not a big fan of rave. I'm not trying to get that across. But any movie that can take a concept and like Mad Max. Mad Max was another rape revenge movie without any actual raping it. Anything that can do that is a great movie in my opinion. So that's why I really like that movie. But I also am saying that because I recently watched it.
Sure.
Yeah. You know what I mean?
Which is like Revenant, I'm thinking of, I just recently watched. But that movie really took me. Not a lot of dialogue, but it's a tour de force of cinematography if you're into that kind of thing.
Which I am.
So, yeah, give that one a watch. And he's not raped by a bear.
I don't know. That looked like a bear rape to me.
It's not a rape.
I'm glad you brought this up because now we can use the hashtag bear rape.
Yes. Hashtag bear rape for episode 33. All right, so...
Was that his only question, Garrett?
No, he had a second part to this question. The second part to this question was, have either of you ever been to Marvin's Marvelous Mechanical Museum in Farmington Hills, Michigan? If not, check it out ASAP. Only a short 30-40 minute drive from Ann Arbor.
Oh, I appreciate it. I think he was telling me that.
Yeah, I think he's trying to get you to go.
Well, I've never heard of it.
Me either.
I have no clue what it is.
Nope.
I didn't even look it up when I saw the question in the inbox.
Me either. So,
no, I don't know. I might go once I look into it. And
sweeten the pot. Maybe we'll come do a three-person
maybe
trip.
Yeah, Derek, if you can meet us there and we can do like a little parking lot episode, I might go up there.
Ooh.
Ooh.
I would like to be in on that even.
It's like...
I like to watch.
See, this is like what I'm getting at. We're talking about gay sex, but we're not directly doing gay sex.
Oh, let's get a script together.
Let's do it.
All right.
We're bound for Hollywood.
All right, Josh, closing up this. What is, or what was, the music played on this episode?
You gave this last episode.
I did. I just got to stop doing that because I'm giving the first song.
Yeah. So, Brian, what did we hear first in this episode?
Thank you, Josh. The first song we listened to was Trent Reznor and David Bowie, of course.
Of course.
I'm Afraid of Americans. I remember this video when I was a teenager on MTV. Really stuck with me. Got me thinking geopolitically.
Ooh, look at you.
And it fit really well, I think, for this.
Well, here's a fun tidbit. That was actually, the version you heard was actually a Trent Reznor remix.
Yes.
The original was written by Brian Eno and David Bowie. If memory serves correctly, it was on the Showgirls soundtrack.
Interesting, right? Showgirls, somehow that made it onto this episode.
That's what I mean. David Bowie finds his way into everything.
6 degrees of Kevin Bowie.
Kevin Bowie. That's the subtitle for the episode. 6 degrees of Kevin Bowie.
All right. What was the next song?
The next song, Brian, we heard was, of course, by David Bowie. I picked this song before we decided to even bring up Flint on the podcast, but the song is called Looking for Water.
And it all just tied right in.
I picked it because it was the end of the world, a bomb dropped, and you know, we need water. But sadly, it also kind of relates to what's going on in Flint.
Yeah. And there was, of course, one more.
One more, and that was I'm gonna fuck this up. I think it's Sue George.
Okay.
Spanish or Mexican? I can't remember. I'm the Scotch is completely.
Just keep going. We're almost there.
It was his cover of Rebel Rebel from the movie The Life Aquatic, with Steve Zissou.
I got you.
Thank you.
Life Raft. I'm throwing out there.
How long have we got left?
Not long, Josh. So, yes, it was from the Life Aquatic with Steve Zissou soundtrack. It was all David Bowie covers, right?
Most of them, yeah. There was some Iggy Pop and Devo.
Lust for Life was on that one.
Search and Destroy.
Oh, Search and Destroy, that's it. That was one of my
favorites. I got you. I'm throwing a life rap for you.
Thank you, yes. That was which is terrible because that was like my favorite part in the whole movie, too.
Yeah, well, you fucked it up.
Yeah, anyways. So that was the music.
Yeah.
Wow.
Wow.
All right. This is what happens when we're in Think and Drink Studio.
That's right. We drink and we think.
Yes. Okay. Well, Josh, I think that's about it. We plugged everything else already. The Facebook, the Twitter.
The MySpace.
The MySpace. No, we didn't say MySpace.
Do we even have a MySpace?
Well, Philosophy Jerks doesn't have a MySpace, but While We Sleep has a MySpace.
Ah, yes. Our old college band that went nowhere.
That went nowhere, but there's a few tracks on there. Thanks to you.
Three demos that...
All right, so you can always check that out.
But realistically, you can check everything out at philosophyjerks.com. Hear us on iTunes, Stitcher, iHeartRadio.
Spread the word.
Spread the word. Word of mouth.
Cure for the common conversation. Everyone wants that.
Yes.
Fuck talking about the weather.
Fuck the weather. Well, how about the 2 feet of snow?
Yeah,
I wonder how Powers is doing over in New York.
Oh, that's right, James. Let us know. Did you survive the blizzard?
Did you get that video? He was worried about not having enough video games to hold him over while he was indoors.
I'm sure he can always revisit Zelda.
Well, or drink Jack and Coke.
There you go. So that's going to wrap it up for episode 33. Come back for episode 34, Josh. We are going to dive into not only the Flint water crisis, but everything that kind of surrounds that whole issue.
Yeah, absolutely. It's going to be almost like a rhyme or parallel to our Centralia, Pennsylvania episode. So it'll be kind of like that in that vein. Although I want to make sure we deal with this ahead of time. I'm going to leave the blame game to the politicians and the news reporters. What I think we want to dive into is what has the water crisis meant for people that actually are in Flint right now? And me being from there, I'm going to hang on up there and, you know, talk around and see what's up.
Dying cities and dirty water.
Ugh.
Going up on episode 34. So join us for that. Send us your questions as always and spread us. And thanks for listening. We love you.
Wait, spread us?
Spread. Just lay back and let it happen.
Oh, boy. Goodbye, right, folks. We'll see you in a couple weeks.
Don't stop thinking.
Bye, everybody. Okay, I just want to make sure that my volumes are going to be good. This is where I'm going to be trying to talk, and I know I'll talk with my hands a little bit. I just got to be careful and cognizant.
Yes.
So if I come down here, though, I kind of feel weird, but it
somewhat
might be
shy.
This might be
pattern.
The good spot, though, I'm thinking. I can just, yeah. Goddamn fucking Democrats, and the table doesn't get pounded on.
Right.
Okay.
All right.